Welcome, everyone. I'm Adam Pellegrini from the Columbia School of Social Work Writing Center, and I want to thank you all for joining us for the Linda and Peter Hoffman Writing Lecture with Dr. Soraya Coley. And now I'd like to introduce Dean Melissa Begg, who became the 18th Dean of Columbia School of Social Work on September 1st, 2019. She is an accomplished scholar, committed educator, and creative administrative leader. Her work has focused on convening interdisciplinary teams, developing innovative curricula, creating mentorship programs, and enhancing diversity in graduate education and research and the research workforce. She is deeply committed to the school's social justice mission and the pursuit of better science for a better society through scholarship, education, practice, and collaboration. Dean Begg?
Welcome, everyone, to an exciting session today. And thank you, Adam, for your kind introduction. I appreciate the great work by you and your committee in organizing today's lecture with our distinguished guest, Dr. Soraya Coley. I also want to thank you for your leadership of the school's Writing Center, which is an excellent resource for our MSW and PhD students, empowering all of them to become stronger, more confident writers in their coursework and beyond. The Linda and Peter Hoffman Writing Lecture was founded in 2004 through the generosity of Linda Hoffman, a 1968 alum of Columbia School of Social Work, and her husband, Peter. Learning firsthand from the immeasurable success of Linda's organization, the New York Foundation for Senior Citizens, Linda and Peter came to believe that administrative writing, especially in preparing successful government and foundation proposals, is an essential skill for Columbia Social Work students and alums. Along with experts in proposal writing, the lecture series has brought speakers such as Deepa Iyer and Marlon Preston to CSSW to speak to our community on important aspects of inclusive writing and writing for advocacy and justice. Linda and Peter's generosity did not stop at the writing lecture. While the lecture is presented every other year, in alternate years, the school awards the Linda and Peter Hoffman Writing Award to students who craft the best proposals, preferably for government funding. Since its inception, the Linda and Peter Hoffman Writing Award has been presented to dozens of students at the CSSW annual commencement. I'd like to say a few words about the New York Foundation for Senior Citizens, of which Linda is founder and president. Established in 1968, the NYFCS helps to meet the needs of seniors across New York's five boroughs. Through Linda's tireless leadership and commitment to aging New Yorkers, the foundation offers unique programming for seniors to enjoy healthier, safer, more productive, and dignified lives. You may have seen news about home sharing with seniors, only one of the many programs for which the organization has received numerous accolades. Linda's dedication and support of her graduate alma mater is uncompromising. Among her many contributions, she served as chair of former Dean Takamura's advisory board, and she has hired many of our graduates into staff positions at the NYFSC. Linda wrote the foreword for the Columbia Guide to Social Work Writing, a leading and first of its kind publication, which provides an introduction to social work writing and scholarship. We are proud to have Linda as an alum of our school, and I can't thank Linda and Peter enough for their generosity and continued support. Now, I have the pleasure of introducing our moderator for this session, a truly wonderful colleague and treasured member of the Columbia social work community, Dr. Yamile M. Marti. Dr. Marti has been on faculty at Columbia School of Social Work since 2011 and was promoted last year to Associate Professor of Professional Practice. Dr. Marti is an exceptional instructor, accomplished clinician, and committed researcher on issues related to children and women in crisis. She has worked at the individual, community, and policy levels within mental health organizations, schools, community centers, and government agencies. Her clinical experience ranges from issues of substance abuse to the child welfare system to therapy and group work with families and children, severe mental illness, cancer, abused women and abused neglected children, among many others. Dr. Marti's research areas include the development of resiliency and coping skills for children and women in crisis or facing adversity, and the implementation and evaluation of interventions that promote positive mental health in children and women. She also focuses on the role of psychosocial and cultural factors on mental health and the use of psychoeducation in multiple settings. Dr. Marti has served as a consultant for UNICEF and the UNDP and has participated in many projects internationally, including in Jordan, Cuba, Brazil, Kenya, and Chile. Having earned her MSW and doctoral degrees from Columbia Social Work, we are also proud to call her an alum and a member of our faculty. Dr. Marti, it's my pleasure to turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dean Begg. And good afternoon to everyone who is joining us today. We have the honor and pleasure of introducing to you our speaker for today, Dr. Coley, who is the president of California State Polytechnic University at Pomona, and an accomplished educator and administrator with 4 decades of experience in higher education. She has been honored by the African American Civic Engagement Project, and an assembly member, Sebastian Riley Thomas, has honored her as well. She's a recipient of many awards, including an honorary doctorate in Humane Letters from Lincoln University and a Trailblazer Award presented by Leadership California. Her numerous publications include Proposal Writing Effective Grantsmanship with Cynthia Scheinberg, and I am proud to say that we use it in all of our proposal writing courses. President Coley's presentations are in a range of fields, including professional development and leadership, academic assessment, human services, and race and gender in higher education. President Coley is the first woman to be named president of Cal Poly Pomona, and she received a bachelor's degree in sociology from Lincoln University and a master's and doctoral degree in social planning and social research from Braemar College. In February 2020, I had the pressure of having President Coley present in my course on proposal writing, and our students found her incredibly knowledgeable and engaging, and we know all of you will find her as well. She's the ideal lecturer for the Linda and Peter Hoffman Writing Lecture. So without further ado, President Coley.
Thank you. First, I want to thank Dean Begg for this opportunity to join you today. And I applaud the Columbia School of Social Work for holding this lecture series. And I commend the Hoffmans for supporting such an activity. I must also acknowledge a former student of yours, Luz Bertildo, who was a 2019-2020 immigrant Student Success Center graduate fellow there at Columbia and is from Pomona, California. I believe she just graduated from your school. I became aware of her through a program called Bright Prospects in Pomona, which works to place high achieving students in universities across the country. She had such a strong desire to attend Columbia, and so I joined with others in providing some financial support. During her last semester, she reached out to me to ask if I'd be willing to guest lecture in Dr. Marti's mini course that was using our proposal writing text, as mentioned, co-authored with Cynthia Scheinberg, which I was so honored to do. So I also want to take a moment to thank Dr. Marti for the invitation and for the introduction. I thought I would begin today's lecture by sharing a little of the evolution of my interest in social work planning and research, and how this continues to inform my approach even today as a university president. As mentioned, I attained my undergraduate degree at Lincoln University, one of the oldest historically Black universities in the country, where I majored in sociology. And as a requirement for the major, I enrolled in a social research class that really piqued my interest about the research process. And among the most impactful assignments given by the professor was that each student had to review early editions of sociology journals, generally pre-1950s, and find a study focused on Black Americans. I came across an article that was confirming the inferiority of Blacks because there were no Black American Olympic swimmers, and it was associated with a perceived smaller brain size in Blacks. From there, we were now to take the finding. So for my article, the finding that there had been no Black Olympic swimmers, and we were to generate alternative hypotheses or factors as to why this might be the case. So I reflected on the fact that as a junior in college, I still did not know how to swim. And why was that? I grew up in the highly segregated community in North Carolina. I attended segregated schools where there were no swimming pools, no parks where we could go to swim. In fact, if you were Black and wanted to swim, you had to go to the river or the creek, and my mother was not going to allow such. In fact, it was not until I was in my 40s and having moved to California that I took my first swimming lesson. But that assignment in which we were being asked to assume the role of researcher and generate other factors that could account for the finding of no Black Olympic swimmers and dispel the original premise of biological inferiority was indeed highly impactful to me. It brought into clearer focus the issues of access and opportunity, which continues to undergird my work today. And as we know, today we have Martiza Correa, who was on the US female Olympic swimming team in 2004, and Cullen Jones, who won 3 medals in swimming in the 2012 Olympics, both African Americans. Also significant in the same course was our examination of how certain concepts were normalized with the larger society as the standard, but they perpetuated a deficit model when those same concepts were overlaid in assessing communities of color. For example, at the time, the larger society defined middle class as having certain levels of income and educational attainment. And without such markers, you were considered lower class. But in my segregated community in North Carolina, individuals were ascribed middle class status due to their leadership and the role played in the community. For example, the Southern Baptist minister, the funeral home director, or the barbershop owner. None with the incomes or educational attainment ascribed by the larger society. So these academic experiences during my undergraduate years created an awareness of the importance of engaging the community in shaping programs and understanding the cultural nuances when conducting research. I came to value how essential cultural competency is in the work that we do. So following my graduation from Lincoln, I attended Bryn Mawr's College Graduate School of Social Work and Social Research, where I attained a master's in social policy and planning, and as mentioned, later received my PhD. I extended my interest in whether and how planning and program development intersect with those for whom the program is intended. So I'm thinking about the aims of today's lecture. I pose the question, as we conceptualize and operationalize ideas for programs to serve the community, how are the intended recipients' experiences, culture, and voices integrated into our planning? Let me repeat that again. As we conceptualize and operationalize ideas for programs to serve the community, how are the intended recipients' experiences, culture, and voices integrated into our planning? And I want to delve into the topic by sharing a case example of how we were moving in the traditional mode of programming, but we ultimately recognized a cultural gap in proposal conceptualization and program implementation, which led us to totally redirect our thinking and turn our planning upside down. Now, in framing the objectives for today's lecture, I advance 3. First, to provide an overview of problem formulation and the components of a proposal. Second, using the case study, identify effective approaches for crafting proposals. And finally, advance strategies for bringing the voice of the community or program participants into the process. Now, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the structure of program proposals because the terminology and the depth of information provided can vary depending upon whether you're seeking government, foundation, and/or corporate funding. But instead, let me briefly review some of the common elements required in most proposals. First, there must be a mission-driven analysis of the organization. This establishes the agency's capability to implement the proposed program plan, including the human and material resources that will be employed. Second, you're expected to craft a problem or need statement that reflects an understanding of those you're intending to serve, the nature and the extent of the need or problem and its impact, factors contributing to the problem or conditions, the barriers in program design, promising approaches for improved results, and the sustainability of the program after the funding ends. Third, there is a formulation of the program's goals and objectives that defines the ultimate desired result for changing conditions or circumstances. In other words, what will change? How will the intended beneficiaries of the program be demonstrably better served? Fourth, a description of the implementation plan is provided that indicates what we typically refer to as your theory of practice. That is, what are the activities, what are the actions that will be taken in order to obtain the desired result as stated in the outcomes? Fifth, what are the progress indicators or measures that demonstrate you're moving in the right direction? What data will be collected to determine the extent to which the outcomes are achieved? And finally, what are your existing assets and new budgetary resources that you are requesting because you have determined they will be necessary in order for you to achieve the outcomes? So those are the general components of a proposal. And in the remaining time we spend together today, I thought I would share a case study that really reiterates the critical importance of having culturally competent individuals as a part of the program planning and implementation process. Let me say at the outset that our proposal was funded, and it became a significant learning experience, not only for me and the rest of the project team, but also for the funding agency, which I will share more about later. So let me provide you the backdrop for this case study. I was a faculty member in the Human Services Department at California State University Fullerton, located in Orange County, California. And beginning in the mid-1980s, I was asked to be a part of an anti-smoking educational program proposal development team that was focusing on working with the Vietnamese community in Orange County, California. The State Public Health Department had released a call for proposals across the state aimed at increasing the awareness of the dangers of smoking and ultimately reducing the smoking-related health problems. In looking at the proposal mandate and the Orange County Public Health Agency's concerns, it led to our focusing on the local Vietnamese community. Let me share a brief history of the resettlement of the Vietnamese in the United States. Some of you may recall that the United States was engaged in the Vietnam War for nearly 20 years, from 1955 to 1975. North Vietnam was fighting South Vietnam in an attempt to overtake them. We entered, that is, the United States entered the war in support of South Vietnam because of our concern with China's expansion and their being close allies with North Vietnam. There was grave concern of the spread of communism to South Vietnam and potentially the rest of Asia. And as the years passed, there were significant American casualties. And after a period of time, there was increasing anti-war protests in America. For many, there just did not appear to be an end in sight in dealing with the war. The South Vietnamese and the Americans were allies. And with the advancement of North Vietnamese in 1975 into South Vietnam, the US military withdrew. And with that, developed a plan to resettle many of the refugees fleeing South Vietnam into numerous communities across the United States. Over 1.6 million Vietnamese were resettled between 1975 and 1997. The oldest and most prominent site was in Orange County, California, with approximately 189,000 Vietnamese brought to the community. And so by the early to mid 1980s, there was growing concern about the health status of the Vietnamese community. It was determined that the high rates of Vietnamese male smokers, many who in fact had gained access to American cigarettes while fighting alongside Americans in the war, were directly related to increasing health problems. Moreover, the county public health was becoming particularly alarmed in seeing significant increases in the respiratory conditions of young children and women. It was believed that living in relatively small quarters, secondhand smoke was a contributing factor for the rise. At that time, it was rare to find female smokers within the Vietnamese population. So now with that as a backdrop, I now want to shift and provide a contrast between some of our initial thoughts on shaping the anti-smoking educational program proposal and what ultimately became a more culturally considered approach. The first element was building the team. As I mentioned, I had been asked to join the research associate at Cal State Fullerton on our campus to respond to a request for proposals for an anti-smoking educational campaign. It was a competitive process across California and did not have a particular target audience. But with the concerns of the Orange County Public Health about the impact of smoking within the Vietnamese community, we thought this would meet the stated aims of the call for proposals. Cal State Fullerton already had connections with a Vietnamese community organization as a result of the increased Vietnamese student population on the campus. I was asked to accompany the research associate to a first meeting to explore the interests of the organization in partnering with Cal State Fullerton on the development of an anti-smoking educational program focused on Vietnamese males. We met with the agency director and staff, and they indicated an interest in partnering with us. But as we asked questions and shared our initial thoughts about how to approach the educational program, they appeared to just accept our ideas without challenging any of our assumptions and approaches. I left feeling that we would not achieve the intended aims of the grant, and that we were ill-equipped to develop a culturally informed proposal. Upon returning to the campus, I insisted that we bring one of the student affairs administrators who was Vietnamese onto the project. She was already deeply involved in supporting the Vietnamese students at Cal State Fullerton. She agreed to join the project team, and we had a follow-up meeting with the agency and asked her to lead the session and solicit the information to help us shape the proposal. We made clear that we needed our proposal to incorporate culturally informed approaches and their ideas in order to achieve the project's goals. This time, and all the subsequent meetings with the agency staff were such a contrast from our first meeting. We intentionally sat off to the side of the room and just listened as our Vietnamese project lead facilitated the meetings, which resulted in an array of ideas from the staff on how best to structure the program. So let me share how the initial thoughts and the planning about this anti-smoking educational program totally shifted after we were willing to listen and learn. Given that it was an anti-smoking educational campaign, one initially thought that the Vietnamese male smokers would be the most likely participants. But this was an incorrect assumption. And we later learned that this was a critical shift in our approach. The agency staff made clear that it would be highly unlikely that the men would participate. They indicated that the after effects of the war, the psychological and economic impacts of the resettlement process, as well as what we've come to know about the addiction associated with smoking, would be deterrents to their participation. As one staff member shared, it would be like saying, "Welcome to America, and now stop smoking." So then we wondered whether we should pursue the proposal. And if so, who should the anti-smoking educational campaign be directed towards? Everyone agreed it was the mothers of these men. It was explained that most of the households were multi-generational, and the men, along with their wives and children, were more than likely living in the same households with their mothers as well as other relatives. So why their mothers? First, the paternal mothers are the ones who are more apt to care for and focus on the health of the household. And most significantly, it was recognized that if they understood the impact of the smoking on the health of their grandchildren, they would be more apt to influence their son's behavior. So with this in mind, let me now share an overview of our approach to achieving the project's educational goals. All the activities were held at the Vietnamese Community Agency. we identified several of the mothers and other women to assist in running the informational and educational sessions. It became Mothers Informing Mothers. Also important was how we used the project's educational materials. Of course, the state had information it wanted to convey in the program, especially informing the participants about the dangers of smoking, as well as educating them about the impact of secondhand smoke. But we decided that we wanted our materials to serve multiple purposes, and they had to be culturally appropriate. So we hired a Vietnamese artist, and along with the agency staff, we developed a manual that contained Vietnamese artwork, Vietnamese sayings, helpful information and resource guide, along with the educational materials about smoking and its effects. In the manual, we had Vietnamese language on one side of the page and the English translation on the facing page. This supported them and their families in also learning English. Large numbers of women attended these educational sessions, but it also evolved into social gatherings as we provided food and the agency added other activities such as sewing. The participants came to look forward to the weekly event. Another important outcome of this project was the changing perspective of the funder. Previously, they had outlined an American cultural approach for mounting an anti-smoking educational campaign. Through our request for programmatic funding exceptions, we educated them about how essential it was to understand the cultural context. Let me share several examples of how we shifted the funders' awareness. Each project was allowed to provide incentives for participants to complete the educational sessions. Such items as notebooks and picture frames were authorized by the state funders. And as we were planning our sessions, we asked for ideas from the staff and from the women who were assisting with the training on the types of incentives they thought the participants would desire. And as you can imagine, rice cookers were not on the state's list. Neither were radios so they could listen to the Vietnamese station. But these were the top items that emerged, and we were able to get an exception from the state to offer these to those women who completed the program. And we had one of the highest completion rates among the funded projects. Additionally, the state provided promotional items to pass out at various community events, like water bottles and sun visors. We said we needed small flashlights. Why? Because the multi-generational families in one household, often sleeping on the floor, they wanted flashlights to avoid disturbing one another if they had to go to the bathroom in the middle of the night. Once again, we helped the state to understand the cultural context in which we were operating. What was key here is we did not presume to know what was desired. We asked what they wanted. So in closing, I would like to share some of the major project outcomes and what was learned. First, we knew that the project was having an intended impact when the community agency staff indicated that the men were upset and complaining that they now had to smoke outside. You see, their mothers would no longer let them smoke in the house, regardless of the weather conditions. So while we shifted our focus away from the male smoker to the impact of secondhand smoke on the family, the men were still being educated indirectly about smoking from their mothers. And their mothers focused on the health of their grandchildren. In fact, the health status of the children and women actually improved. The next learning and outcome was that the manual developed was being used in a variety of settings across the community to help individuals learn English and become aware of various resources available. It also strengthened the ties between Cal State Fullerton and the Vietnamese community. We recognized how important it was to partner with them in supporting the matriculation of the Vietnamese students and promoting the awareness of college degree attainment. And finally, it reiterated how essential it is that we constantly test our assumptions about how to engage and partner with diverse communities and to remain open to being a culturally reflective scholar and practitioner. Again, thank you so much for this opportunity, and may you find fulfillment in your work and your life's pursuits.
Thank you, Dr. Coley. That was a great lecture, and I really resonated with your last point about testing our assumptions in the field of the communities and groups that we work with. It's such an important part of the work that we have to do. Mm-hmm. So we have some audience questions, and we invite the audience to also share any questions they might have in our chat. The first question is, what are some ideas for how to measure efficacy on new programs in the area of mental health or substance abuse that you can share with the audience?
Well, I think that it also depends upon the nature of the mental health problems that you are that you're dealing with. But I would say that one has to look at both in terms of the ability to function. One has to also look at the extent to which people are able to articulate whether or not they are seeing progress. Mm-hmm. I think that it really is such a difficult area to tackle, and I applaud all of those who are working in this area. I think certainly the pandemic has really brought into full focus the mental health issues associated with isolation, associated with despair, associated with the dealing with and being challenged by the economics of the pandemic. And so one has to look at, as you are intervening or as you're engaging, then are you seeing, or is there a story that comes out that's more hopeful? Is there a recognition that people are articulating that they feel better? I think that it is both the professional judgment, but also the various ways in which, through long-term relationship, that you're able to see progress. You know, one of the things that brings to mind is that I remember when we went into virtual mode, and I received an email from a student who was was part of our Disability Resource Center. And she shared that while she understood us having to move into this virtual mode, that every day that she was able to go to class, it was a statement of her progress. Mm-hmm. And so now she was not going to be able to go to class. She wasn't going to be able to prove to herself that she was managing her mental state. Mm-hmm. And so those are the things that really prompted us to make sure that we reached out to students, that though we were not in person, that we reached out to them to let them know that we still wanted some type of engagement. And so the qualitative nature of this work is one that it is both the ability to assess generally around some framework, some professional framework, but also to really cue off of what you are hearing. Mm-hmm. from those that you are engaging. And quite frankly, I think that as we come back, hopefully in the fall, maybe early in the summer, that we in leadership roles, in helping, in professional helping roles, we ourselves are going to have to take an inventory of our own state, but we're going to particularly need to make sure that we don't expect to immediately get back to where we were before the pandemic.
Yeah.
We're going to have to be sensitive to the evolution and what is, how do we integrate and connect after in this post-pandemic environment. But it's a great, great question.
Yeah, and I hear you that we have to sort of pay attention to the moment that we are assessing and looking at efficacy in the work that we do. We have a question from our audience. While we all strive for the perfect proposal, is it true that I have heard that one mistake, even if it's a typo, will result in a failed proposal? Well, I think we all have been there.
Yeah, and you know, I oftentimes, when I first started, I was teaching at Cal State Fullerton, and as I was working with professionals who were in the field and also students, I said, the first thing is you don't tie your sense of well-being and accomplishment to the outcome of a proposal. Because I used to sit on the panel that federal panel that reviewed proposals. And so 9 times out of 10, it is rare to get the first proposal funded. Mm-hmm. But it's an important process because it is, you get feedback, it's a learning process. And what oftentimes happens, and again, this depends upon federal proposals as opposed to, for example, foundation or corporate proposals, where many times there is a relationship between the agency organization and the proposed funder. But unlike when you are submitting for state and federal grants, there is not that relationship. They don't call you up or come to visit your agency. It is what's on the page. And so it is important. One of the things that I always encourage folks to do is, first of all, particularly as you're writing collaboratively, to have someone who's going to put it all together and have someone in the group who really can critique and check for spelling, for wording, because there is, for example, I can remember at one point we received several hundred proposals, but we were only going to award 20. So it's very competitive. And so you also need, and one of the things that I have really stressed over the years is how you articulate the need or the problem. because everyone's putting forth that there is a need for this program. And there's an awareness that there is great need in so many areas in our society. But the important point is, how will your proposed approach demonstrate, and let me say demonstrate, that in fact, the intervention, the program, the way in which you are engaging really made a difference. And what we find is that too often, it is give me money because I need money to help this problem. Well, the funders are needing to understand. And many times I found myself when I was at Cal State Fullerton, actually providing support to agencies, because they were fantastic service providers, but they didn't have the understanding of how to put the proposal together. Mm-hmm. And so part of what I also hope is that groups will be available to agencies to help them, to support them in the writing, in the way in which it is articulated. And so unfortunately, that spelling error could lead to it being set aside if in fact you have another proposal that demonstrates how it's going to achieve the results, measures it, and has no errors. So it is, but I think it's just about continuing to do it. It is something that can be learned. And it is, someone asked about demonstrate, it means provide specific. It is being able to know that before the program or this intervention, it looked like X. Afterwards, it looked like Y. Now, how will you convey Y? Is it going to be through data? Is it going to be through the stories of the recipients? So how do you demonstrate that in fact you had the kind of impact that you want? One of the things that I am very impressed with so many of the foundations who used to sit in the offices and receive proposals, now many times they do site visits because they know that the writing of the proposal may not be a good indication of the quality of the program and the services and the need for that program. So they go and visit the sites, which I think is another important dimension.
And that's an important point that you bring that leads me to a question of one of our audience members. They asked, can you speak more about the strategies you use to shift the funder's approach? And how did you educate them to see the relevance of the cultural context that's so, it's so major to what you have talked about today?
And tell me again, what was the first part of that question?
Yes, can you speak more specifically about the strategies used to shift a funder's approach, and how do you educate them to see the relevance of the cultural context?
Well, I don't know that necessarily you shift the funder's approach, but now I think most funders recognize, and particularly when I'm thinking of foundations and even some of the corporate funders, they recognize the importance of a qualitative assessment, mm-hmm. not just the data, not just the numbers, but that that's why they will then visit the organization. And when they visit, they want to see very clearly that this is where we were at time one. This is what we did. This is how we included the community. This is how the community is representative and supportive and helped to inform our strategy. And then they more often will hear from members of the community, members of the groups that you are serving. And so, but they're very astute in the way in which they assess because they want to understand the depth of knowledge and the depth of commitment and a clear and having confidence that indeed, if we're giving you these dollars, that you can in fact move, you know, it may be moving from 1 inch to 5 inches, but you're able to move towards a better outcome, towards a better state for those that you are serving. And many times, I think that it's important, even as we looked at the problem, as I said, the case study that I used, you know, we said, okay, well, we gotta educate these male smokers. They need to know that, you know, all of the health risk. Well, that was kind of the normal way we would go about thinking about setting up a program. But when we listened and when we understood, and particularly when they're saying, I don't care what incentives you offer, the men are not going to come to sit and listen about stop smoking. They want to hold on to their Camel cigarettes and their Marlboro cigarettes that the Americans took over to South Vietnam. And so we had to step back and said, we even wondered, should we go ahead with the proposal? But what was nagging us was the increases in respiratory conditions for the children and the wives. And we said, something else is happening here. And so I think it is, as we're educated, we certainly bring our theoretical perspectives, we bring our knowledge, we bring our understanding, the way we've observed things, we count things, we research things. But I think it's also important to always stay open to nuances, to new learning, to a way of looking at something that you hadn't seen before. And I think we have to make sure that we don't get our professional persona in the way of really engaging and having people understand that it's a joint learning. I learned more. I mean, I had the PhD, but I learned more, but I also contributed. So it, I think that we have to be open to the partnership that we form.
Yeah, that reciprocity is so important in the learning process.
Correct.
Do you suggest a needs assessment be completed prior to conducting community grant writing to get an idea of the issues, or would you recommend town halls or maybe focus groups?
I think all of that. I think you need to do, and for many of you that are in agencies and organizations, you have longstanding history. You've learned what are some of the factors that work and what are some of the things that need to be changed. And I think that as long as we stay in the learning mode, it evolves. We improve, we increase our awareness. And so I do think that, you know, it is important that we do the needs assessment, because more often than not, by the time a proposal is called for, you have a very short window in which to get this. And I always said with the agencies that I worked with in Orange County, you should keep in your desk a overview of what you've accomplished, the profiles of the people that you serve, the needs of that community, so that you can pull it out at any time. And then when you're writing a proposal, it will typically provide you with the framework. But recognize that, and particularly for so many of our nonprofits, you know, we are so there's a need to always be looking for other streams of revenue, of other sources of funding. So it's important that you always have a general understanding of what are we trying to accomplish? What is the impact? How are people going to be better off because we are doing A, B, and C, and how do we know it? It can't just be, well, I infer it. Mm-hmm. It has to be something because you are trying to really establish a compelling reason to get the support. And someone just mentioned, it also is important because many times you're restricted to the number of pages, the word count, and so forth. So that's why I always encourage the agencies at all times be able to have an overview of the great work your agency is doing along with a needs assessment that you can adapt depending upon the requirements of the funder.
Great. Another audience member asked, did the men in the program eventually see the benefits of the program and participated with the goal of smoking reduction?
There was many years later, but, and I think it was part of, and some of you may recall, it was part of a whole national campaign around anti-smoking. But what was so profound to us is that the mothers of these men were not kidding. I remember talking to one gentleman and he said, it was raining and it was cold and I had to go stand outside to get a smoke because she was not going to let me smoke around my children. And I said, well, you say that to your mother, I doubt you will. And so again, we needed to be, and yes, we understood the all of the dangers associated with smoking, but there was also a psychological dimension for what smoking provided. Mm-hmm. And when you think about, again, in South Vietnam, they had many of them had businesses, they were self-sufficient, they were living their lives, and then to be uprooted and be placed in a totally foreign environment and the stress associated with that. So in many ways, we understood the health factors, but we also needed to find a way that was going to be the secondary, which became primary, the secondary focus around the secondhand smoke and its impact on, we were beginning to see really big numbers of children, 5, 6, elementary school children with these respiratory problems. But again, it wasn't just in Orange County or among the Vietnamese community. Many of you will recall, particularly in the 80s, you don't see it as much on television now, but there was huge anti-smoking campaigns to try and limit. Airplanes, you could no longer smoke on an airplane. You used to be able to smoke there. So it was part of the evolution in our country about educating people about the dangers of smoking.
Great, thank you for that. So we have a colleague of ours at the school, Dr. Kapadia, who mentioned that she teaches the proposal writing with me, along with other colleagues using your book. And one of the things that we try to teach in our classes is that we want to consider program development in ecological system and with collaborative approaches, including the complex dynamics of racism and other forms of discrimination in the ways in which we create programming. And she says, this lens does not always transfer to the ways in which funding structures create the funding proposals or in the ways the structure proposals, even in terms of writing. What are some suggestions that you might have that we can do this kind of structure of collaborative processes and tackling those issues?
Yeah, and I think that's a great question. In fact, I really worked with and encouraged collaborative proposals with agencies. And I think that foundations and corporations were more willing, more open to receiving those kinds of proposals because they had much more, they weren't as structured or within the box as sometimes many federal funding programs were. As you said, as I said, you know, I had to talk to the folks about just wanting to buy rice cookers. You know, they're saying, no, you can't have, well, it's the same amount of money and they don't want a notebook. They want a rice cooker. They want things that are part of their lives and that help them. And so I think with collaboration, you have to have, I think, an overarching framework of how, what is the problem? What's the shared problem that you're working on? And then what are the particular contributions of each? And how will you measure the both the impact of the collaboration? I think it's important to identify that the collaboration, in fact, in some cases, can create a more impactful and greater outcome because you have the benefit of organizations that are looking at it from different perspectives. Most problems are not a single source. So when you're able to put things together, I think that it actually enhances. But again, I think federal guidelines are pretty standard, and that's why I think having seeking foundation support, other kinds of funding that even allows them to come and visit and see the interplay, I think it's important. The other thing I would say as an aside is that many times agencies do so much with so little. And I do think that agencies should also look at collaborating around some of the basic functions. Mm-hmm. A shared budget person, a shared staff around just operations so that they would have the benefit of that skill and that talent. Too often, as I said, you know, we work in silos and isolation. And I do think that more we can come together and share the resources, the stronger the capacity for the organization to get its work done will be.
Mm-hmm. We have an audience member that asks, any tips on how to insert impact and urgency in proposals for existing necessary programs rather than new projects with a clear behavior change? So trying to work with what we have rather than necessarily, you know, reinvent something new. How do we make that happen?
Yeah, I do think, and that's an important question. A lot of times we do feel as if, well, we got to come up with a new idea. We got to have a new, and I think in many ways you have an advantage because if you're able to say, you know, we have been doing this for 5 years, and we have recognized that we now need to expand significantly our outreach, or we need to make this available to different populations than we served before, or the changing community has meant that we need to bring in groups in other ways. So you have a foundation, you have a good story to tell, but it means then how, and hopefully you're able to, over those years, you're able to have collected some data, both qualitative and quantitative data, that shows that what you're doing is working. And now, as you want to, quote unquote, go to scale in addressing some of these problems, we are ready to do that because we already have a track record. So I don't think it always has to be from, you know, well, let's do something new, because in some ways that can work against you in the proposal review process. If you have no demonstrated experience of having even addressed this before, the proposal is a statement that you want to have the funders confident that you can achieve the goals. And so if you have a good track record, I think that that in many ways is how do you fit that track record relative to whatever the funder is, whatever the solicitation of the funder is about. So I do think that there is something to be said by just the ongoing excellence that has occurred.
And learning from what we already know rather than doing something new.
Exactly.
Another audience member said, when you say demonstrate, do you mean provide a specific examples of their needs or problems? The example of the flashlights because family members have slept on the floor came to mind.
And so when you say demonstrate, the flashlights on the floor had more to do with, that wasn't part of the project. It was that the public health agency wanted to advertise, if you will, about to various community events, stop smoking. And so they give these kind of giveaway gifts, as I said, sun visors, water bottles. Well, these individuals that have been uprooted from their homes, they were very clear about some of the practical needs they had. And so the flashlights related more to, if we're gonna bring them all together and have, you know, a stop anti-smoking fair, and people are gonna walk around and pick up gadgets, they want flashlights. And it was amazing, because when I was trying to explain to the person in public health, because we had the money, it was, I had to get the approval that don't send us 500 water bottles, send us 500 flashlights. And so they finally got it. And so I do think that, those flashlights were more of a symbol of our recognizing that to the extent that we could be more culturally sensitive and aware in what we provide and what we do, then it affirms to the participants that we're listening, that we want this to be a partnership, or something that we want you to understand. And so I can remember in talking to the woman at public health, she says, well, I've never heard of this before. I said, well, you probably have not had been in an environment where you have 189,000 refugees resettled in a community that's trying to get their equilibrium, that's trying to figure out how now to move ahead. And so she took it up the chain, and I know they were wondering over and over, why did we fund them? Because in some ways, and they did say at the end that they learned so much as a way of even the way they want to write proposal solicitations, because it was important that it should not have been a Cal State Fullerton project. It was a project that mattered to this community. And so that's why I'm saying, even when you prepare proposals, starting with the how is this articulated? And in many ways, you become the translator to the funder as to what the community needs and wants and indicates.
So truly centering it in the people that you're working with rather
That's
than
right.
sort of the funding.
That's right.
Another audience member asks, are you aware of programs that focus on helping grassroots organizations write proposals? Is this target issue a focus for a grant proposal for organizations that work with grassroots organizations to build their grant writing capacity?
Well, I know that there used to be a, I think there used to be something called a Grantsmanship Center. I don't know if they still are available, but one of the things that I did when I was at Cal State Fullerton, I actually, I taught proposal writing classes as you are doing, but I also, because I had some grants and so forth, I also, every summer, had proposal and grant writing workshops. Mm-hmm. And so we would have 100 to 200 people these people were from education, they were from community organizations, they were from religious institutions. And the only thing I think we charged was like maybe $15 for lunch. And we brought them to Cal State Fullerton and we had grant writing sessions for them. And we told them to come as teams. So they would bring their staff and they would spend, and sometimes we had a 2-day or 3-day, and we would walk them through the process and we would have them actually bring their ideas and to be able, and they could sort through this. And I think it's just very, very important because as with so many things in our society, it's not about talent, it's not about commitment. It's about having the access and the opportunity. Mm-hmm. And so, many of our nonprofits, they do extraordinary work, but they may not have the training or the way to translate. In some ways, it's like a foreign language, mm-hmm. that you're translating what you're doing every day. And I remember talking to one agency director says, well, they ought to just know we're doing good work. I said, you're absolutely right. But there are 500 people, 500 agencies that are saying we're doing good work, and there's only going to be funding for 30 of them. So you have to also have that kind of mindset. And I think the earlier point around collaboration is really, really important. I think the more we do that, the more. But I would encourage, you said there, there was the Grantsmanship Center. There are other organizations, and in some cases, I know that foundations have provided, some training and support for. But we did it as part of our Center for Collaboration there at Cal State Fullerton, and said it was wonderful to have. We'd have every summer these workshops. And then we would have intermittent other kinds of training.
And you're talking in sort of about that training collaboration and also community agencies and collaborating with people who know how to write these proposals and can try to get funding. But do foundations and other private funders help champion proposals and projects with other funders to help garner support? That's one of our audience questions.
Yeah, in fact, let me just, one of the things that's happened, there was here even at Cal Poly Pomona, we have in the CSU, we're one of 23 campuses in the California State University system. There was a call from a cluster of foundations to have proposals around student success, which was improving retention and graduation rates. And so there was the one funder who And so there were a number of institutions that applied. We applied. We didn't get that funding, but this cluster of foundations read the proposal. So they contacted us separately to say, we want to get a proposal from you because we were really impressed with the kinds of things that you wanted to do. And so I think there are these opportunities where foundations come together and other organizations. It used to be, and I doubt that this is still the case, but I remember years ago, United Way used to provide some of this training and development for. And I know that we, when I was at Cal State Fullerton, we also had through continuing education, these kinds of workshops for the community that was directly tied to the human services program. And we had it at significantly reduced cost. But it created, some other avenues, other sources for this information.
Mm-hmm. This is an interesting question. I'm looking forward to hearing your answer. What if funding does not come your way? Is it appropriate to fund it yourself?
Well, I think if you have the resources, I mean, that's a rare question.
I know.
if you have the resources, because in some ways, your initial funding might be a catalyst for then getting future funding. Mm-hmm. Because if you're saying, I feel so strongly about this that I'm just going to fund it myself, but I think you have to be concerned about the sustainability of that. And so even though you may be the catalyst, I think you still need to be thinking about sustainability, because you are providing a wonderful opportunity for people. And then to be, to not have it anymore, it can have an impact that you don't want. And so it's a, but certainly, there's this catalyst funding.
Sort of the pilots to showcase what we're trying to do.
Yeah.
Can you comment on the challenges in which funders expect to see results in the short run, but the reality is that the major problems that we're trying to work for and with cannot be solved, and social change doesn't happen on such a short timeline?
That question is kind of at the heart of the challenges that we have. And one of the things that I argue for is that the proposal is also educating the funder. The funder is trying to ascertain whether or not they can have confidence that you understand the dimensions of the need or the problem. And that you're going to take now this one slice and work on it, but you recognize that with this slice, there's so many other dimensions. And I think what a funder appreciates is that when you have that kind of knowledge, when you're able to articulate the holistic dimensions of the problem, but I'm just going to, for this point in time, because I only have 1 year. Your funding is for 1 year, and I am not going to reduce homelessness in 1 year. I am not going to do A, B, and C in 1 year, but what I am going to do is to say that I'm going to achieve A, B, and C, and it will be a foundation upon which to build in subsequent proposals. It will be a foundation, and we will have learned from that. So it is as much about your ability to articulate and generate confidence in the funder that you've got your arms around this. you see the magnitude and you're not going into it starry-eyed and that I just want to do good. You're going in it with a very strategic approach that's going to try to deconstruct all of the problems and work on this dimension with this funding. And we're going to demonstrate how, that is, we're going to be able through our qualitative and quantitative data analysis, show you how we moved the meter. But we should not be going in with, you know, we're going to end A, B, and C in 1 year with your $50,000. The funder will, it just won't generate the confidence. But I do think 9 times out of 10, if you're successful, the funder then wants to refund you. Mm-hmm. Wants to continue to, because you are building a story. You're building a demonstrative impact program.
I'm going to quote you in class when you say the proposals is also about educating the funder. That's an incredibly important point, and we need to think about it that way when we write them. Another audience question is, it's a great point about highlighting our track record of success. What about those of us who might be starting out and how might we through the proposal process demonstrate to a funder our ideas for programming are worth funding?
What was the first part of that?
What about those of us who might be starting out and we might want to ask for a funder, you know, funding in a proposal, and how we showcase that our ideas for programming are worth funding?
Yeah, you know, I think that many funders, more often than not, it is rare for them to, they may do what we call pilot funding. And that may be, it's kind of like the first project, and we're going to pilot this. But remember that the funding with these foundations, they are accountable to the board and to the ultimate philanthropic group to demonstrate that they use their funding wisely. And so that's why it's important to really start with clarity about what you're trying to achieve, clarity about how you're going to do it, and clarity about how you know if you were successful, and to be able to articulate even when there was not the success you wanted. Because what that shows is that you understand more fully the dynamics of the issue and the problem, that you were only able to take this portion of the issue. Let's say it may have been, maybe it had been mental health, but you weren't able to improve their economic circumstances because they need job training, and job training might be the next portion of what you're trying to do. So I think, and there was something about being persistent with funders. Funders typically will, one of the things that changed is that funders used to accept, and now I'm not talking about the federal funding, funders used to accept unsolicited proposals, mm-hmm. but now most of them don't. They will say, you know, we want to first get to know you. We want to first, it's about the confidence that if we share this funding, that you will be able. And that's why many of them will do site visits. They will they will scrutinize whether or not there is evidence that you can do this work. If you get the funding, then you're more apt to get multi-year funding subsequently. Yeah. And so there is this, so it's rare that, you know, you can just send in a proposal and say, this is the best thing ever. Nine times out of 10, they won't look at it.
Very, very good point. And I think all of us have been in that initial phase of submitting things that we know they never read, but we have to keep trying.
That's exactly right. But you know, that's the other thing. The work that we do and the care that we have about improving outcomes for people is so compelling. We have to be optimists. We cannot, you know, just give up. Our communities can't afford it, and the society needs us to stay in the game, needs to keep us there. And it is our resilience and our persistence that is what I think sustains our work. And so I commend all of you. I commend for going into completing social work and gaining your degree, or you may be in the program now, but it is about I've said oftentimes that social workers are some of the most hopeful people in the world. We have to be. Mm-hmm. We have to. We cannot become so despondent. And this pandemic, I think, has really stretched all of us to try to find that continued fight, mm-hmm. that continued knowing that this is the work that we are called to do. So I commend all of you for the important contribution and the commitment that you have. And so I'm just so thrilled to have the invitation and to share some of my thoughts. And as I said, I hope all of you will find the work that we do is about our passion. And if it's no longer passionate, it takes its toll. And so I'm just so proud of all of you and what you're doing there at Columbia.
Thank you. And we are delighted to have you. We have a couple more questions for you, because everyone is excited to be able to ask you questions today. What is the biggest challenge for being the translator, as you said, to the public health people who wanted to donate water bottles versus the needed flashlights? Assuming the public health people are not that culturally aware, like how was that as a challenge, and how were you able to be a translator?
Well, one of the things that I did was I gave them the backdrop. See, from their perspective, this was a request for proposal that went out to the whole state. And so I had to educate them about what was unique for Orange County. It was the largest resettlement site for the Vietnamese. And so that wasn't even on their radar screen. It was, we have funding that is going to go from Humboldt to San Diego and all in between. And what I did was I had to, in some ways, ask, are you more focused on following the guidelines or achieving the results? Because see, sometimes we get locked into, this is the way it's supposed to be done. And I said, those guidelines, those American norms of operating will not achieve ultimately what we want as shared outcomes. So I had to have them agree that yes, we do want children and the household to not have secondhand smoke conditions. So how do we do that? And so in fact, we brought into the discussion secondhand smoke because their whole anti-smoking campaign was directed towards the people who smoke. So we had to say, this is an audience that certainly needs this information, but this is not the approach. And I think what we learned from that, and they were receptive to that, but again, you know, many times in government kinds of roles, you're pretty structured. Mm-hmm. You know, you stay within the box. And now I'm trying to get them to move outside that box. And so when we started presenting the data, and particularly when I, because they sent all this, you know, nice little flyers and comic books about smoking. And I looked at it, I said, we're not sharing this stuff. And I couldn't tell them that. What I had to do was to take that information. And when we did that manual with Vietnamese artists, when we were able to put Vietnamese sayings, it was amazing. We had to constantly reprint the book because it wasn't just about the people in the program, because now they were side by side able to learn Vietnamese and English. And so when we shared this with the state, I think they became much more cognizant and sensitive about this. So someone had asked the years, and this is probably in the 80s. I started at Cal State Fullerton like in 1981. So it was in the mid 80s that we were doing. And whenever, you know, those, it said huge anti-smoking, you don't see it as much now, but there were huge anti-smoking campaigns across, you know, across the country.
We have another great question. I hear you highlight qualitative and quantitative data, which I admire. What are your recommendations for helping social workers collect this data and manage their worries related to collecting that data?
Well, you know, I do think that, you know, our work really requires us sometimes to, you know, have to do so many jobs at one time. And I don't think that the data oftentimes has to be, I don't think it's long, you know, surveys and huge data collection, depending upon the circumstances. But I do think you have to be thoughtful about answering the question, what does success look like? Mm-hmm. How will we know that we're successful? And what data would best provide us evidence that we were successful? And so I think that what we have found, and I actually was on the board of a number of nonprofit organizations, and we would oftentimes bring in, we had internships in the organization with students who had research backgrounds. And it was a wonderful experience for them. It helped the nonprofit organization. But there also, there may be individuals, for example, who may want to be hired as a consultant. And sometimes when we use the term consultant, it seems like, you know, we're talking about thousands and thousands of dollars. It doesn't always have to be that. But having someone who actually, sometimes you can have a shared agency consultant. So mm-hmm. you're hiring, because what you're working on, you're going to be collecting one kind of data, another agency will be collecting a different kind of data. So it doesn't mean that you are doing the same thing. So there are a number of ways in which you have to, you know, you try to think about it. But as agency director and heads, it is so critical to be able to have both the qualitative and quantitative understanding of what you are doing. And nowadays, there are condensed versions of books and others that help, that educate you a lot better than they were when I, you know, when I started out in the 80s.
That's great, because I think everyone is sort of always a little bit scary about the data collection process, but we are more than equipped because we tend to know all the aspects of the community and the people we're working with. Yeah. Another great question is, if the funder says no or leans towards no, do you recommend being persistent and in parentheses pushy?
No, because in fact it can turn off the individual, because what you're actually saying is you didn't know what you were doing when you told me no. And so now you just, you know, affronted the funder that said, you know, take a look at this again and next time get the right answer, which is yes.
Yeah.
You know, so you have to be mindful of that. But what you can do is to approach the funder, you know, we really worked very hard on this. Are there any insights that you can provide that so in the future we can incorporate? And many times they're very willing, and the fact that you are approaching it that way, it kind of files it in the back of their mind. And so when they see your proposal again and that you've taken in consideration some of the things that they've said, they're apt to be much more receptive. So don't jump in the funder's face.
Don't be pushy.
Yeah.
Do you have experience, Dr. Coley, with funders who support trust-based philanthropy, or do you think the philosophy is authentic?
That what kind of philanthropy?
Trust-based philanthropy.
So these are individuals who have trust accounts and provide funding.
I think that they that's the aim of the question. Yes.
Well, and I think that one of the things, and I don't know, I do know about trust, and I know that there are also community foundations, and there are also people who have trust. And what you have to make sure is that you understand the parameters, the guidelines around that those trusts. They may be wanting you to do something that you aren't really able to do. And so you don't want a situation of over-promising, and then those funds are, you know, are pulled away. But now there are these entities now where people are pooling resources and they are developing, you know, a request to support and do good. You know, now you see just during this pandemic, you see more and more companies, individuals giving away funds, and you want to be able to make sure you understand, are there any, what are the expectations in receiving these funds? And, or, you know, read the fine print to make sure that you don't find yourself in a situation of over promising and then getting into difficulty later.
Okay. I think everyone in the audience, including me, is curious about your answer for this one. When you're reading proposals, what is the first or most important point you look for?
I oftentimes will start with the outcomes, the goals and the outcomes, you know, and that's typically sometimes in the middle of the proposal. But I look there because it's telling me that if this is funded, that this is going to be the impact, how people will be experience things differently, how you will try to whittle away at the problems. It tells me where you're heading. And then I'll go back and start with, you know, a history and understanding the organization, the way you've defined the needs. And I then look at the implementation plan. If you implement this plan, will it in fact lead to the outcomes that you've established? Sometimes we have wonderful outcomes, but the implementation plan does not connect with how to get to those outcomes. And they all have to be linked. And so I typically start in the middle of the proposal, which is with the goals and the outcomes, so that it will provide me, it answers the so what. Mm-hmm. So if you get this money, how will the intended recipients be better off? How will this problem just move just a little bit further away from it being a problem? Mm-hmm. And so the so what is something that many times we don't think about because we're driven from our passion. We're driven from wanting to, you know, just so many things that we want to do, and we don't want to lose that. But we have to combine that, particularly when you think about this being a competitive process. So you've got to be able to articulate that passion into how it's going to benefit those who are a part of this effort, as a part of this program. Mm-hmm. And as I said, it is, I have such empathy and recognition of how challenging that is, because it's kind of combining the quantitative, the qualitative, and the our experiences, our leadership, our ways of viewing the world. It all kind of comes together. And as I said, do not, and let me repeat this again, do not attach your ego to a proposal. Mm-hmm. A proposal, it just means I learned something and I'll do it again. But there are just so many no's. And sometimes I've worked with agencies and they're so despondent because they've put everything into it. And they get this and they just wonder, well, you know, why bother? No, learn from it. It's a continuous learning process.
Because that's another quote that we're gonna use from you.
That's right. Don't give up, because the people you're intending to serve need you to stay at the table.
And around that question, which I find very interesting, one of our audience members said that they're seeking funding for an inclusive community center in a small town. Do you have any recommendations for rural areas funding? Because it's not as easy as big cities.
Right. And I think you want to, there are a couple of things that I would suggest, and I don't know to the extent that we still have. We used to have the county extension agencies, and many universities have connections with county extension agencies. That's number one. There is also looking at state programs. There are a number, for example, like rural health and education. And you want to also see if you can partner with, for example, the school district. Is there something that you can partner with the school district? And then together, you are seeking foundation funding. Are there companies and businesses that are situated there that are part of a corporate structure? And many times corporations, because it becomes a write-off, corporations will fund programs and projects. And so is there some kind of company in the community that might be part of a larger and having the businesses come and see what you're trying to do? You might also develop a rural community advisory group that's comprised of maybe someone from the faith community, someone from the education community, someone from business community, someone that has influence. And so you create your kind of partners and work together. And there are funders who recognize, you know, one of the things that we discovered in this process with this pandemic is how so many communities did not have access to Wi-Fi technology. Mm-hmm. And we actually also had to, for the students in our campus, you know, we ended up handing out about 600 and so laptops. They Wi-Fi spots. They were living in homes where, you know, they, as one student shared with me, you know, his study was in the bathroom because there were 5 children in the house. And so that was the quiet place. And many, we found in the Future of Work Commission that I was on, the absence of technology in so many of our rural communities. And so I think being able to stay focused on that, and also the representatives from your community, the voices, you know, how does that play out in the state house? How do you keep those issues uppermost in people's minds? And so I do think that forming a network is really important. Prior to coming to Cal Poly Pomona, I was in Bakersfield, California, and that is a large agrarian area. And we had some of the food producers to work with us in trying to address some of these issues. We had Chevron that was also based there, the State Farm. So they actually came together and worked with us.
Okay. Dean Beck actually had a question. Dr. Coley, you spoke beautifully of the incorporation of diverse voices in grant writing. Do you have any advice for us on how to best reflect that in the proposal itself?
Well, I do think that it gets reflected, first of all, in terms of the team that you're putting together. They typically want to know within the proposal the profile of the individuals at the agency or at the organization. And so I think it is important to say up front that given the nature of the population we serve, our commitment to being an equity-minded organization, that these are the individuals that make up the team that will be part of serving or meeting the goals of this community. Also, what does your advisory group look like? How diverse is your board of directors or your organization? So there are a number of ways that I think that gets reflected. And then depending upon the makeup of the recipients of the service, how have you staffed things in such a way that it connects with a understanding and appreciation and respect for the cultural nuances of various communities. So it really did, as I said, we had to, we had to throw away our initial thought about, you know, we're just going to write this proposal on smoking and try to educate people about not smoking. And it was one of the most impactful lessons for me. And it certainly helped to reinforce the need of, we need to work cross-culturally, but we need to make sure that we also are open to the expertness of everyone. Mm-hmm. And so it's a great question.
So we wanted to ask if you had any other thoughts you wanted to share before we bring this session, this incredible session and wealth of knowledge that you have shared with us today to our close.
Well, I'm just thrilled. The only thing that would make it better is if I could visit in person.
Hopefully you will.
I am so missing getting out. You may not know, I am the president's house is on the campus of Cal Poly Pomona, and my excitement is every day walking to the mailbox, hoping I'll see someone. But there's typically no one there. And so I'm just hoping that the next time I'm in New York, I'll look forward to coming over and visiting. But I do want to commend you on what I think is a very unique series. And I want to again commend the Hoffmans for investing in this, because I think it is rare, and I really do commend the dean and others. And Dr. Marty, I look forward to our paths crossing again. Again, thank you so much for that invitation to speak in your class.
Thank you.
Well, that was amazing. Thank you, President Coley and Dr. Marty, for a fantastic session. We are so fortunate to be learning from outstanding leaders like you from across the country. What makes for a successful proposal, especially in the vital area of proposal writing for community services funding? You shared so many pearls of wisdom, both big picture down to the utterly practical, down in the weeds. So in particular, to me, your attention to incorporating diverse voices, especially program participants, is absolutely crucial. This is clearly an important anti-racist practice that we all need to adopt. So thank you for bringing our focus back to listening to our community partners and community members as essential to community empowerment. And I join you in thanking the Hoffmans for their incredible gift that made this possible. And I will sign off saying thanks to all the hopeful, strong, effective social workers who have joined us today. Take care, everybody.